No, these are some recent pictures from within 100 kilometers of IIT Bombay. And the big question is that in spite of such scientific advances, why does Manisha have to fetch water like this? And why does Anil use rudimentary tools? And Hirabai have to cook on such smoky chulas? So by the way, about 25% of rural Maharashtra women, you know, fetch water like this, and about 40% cook on chulas. So the real question is that this is really important. And now let us see how this connects with science. So science, as we know, is there's a universe of questions or of phenomena. And then there is a world of science, that which is explained by laws of science, like S equal to UT plus half AT squared, F equal to Q1, Q2 upon R squared. And then there is the great unknown, you know, of that which is not yet explained by science. And in that, of course, is the enchanted world of myths, of stories, of songs, of seasons and nature. Right, but that's another day. Right, let us come back to science. Now we know that there is a world, there is a method of science of converting an unknown into a known. So for example, if you're talking about bubbles, so the three parameters which concern bubbles are their, say, radii, maybe the viscosity of the fluid, and ambient pressure and temperature. So then we observe hundreds of bubbles and make a hypothesis or a theory, and we announce it to the people, so the theory and all the data, and then we wait. So a lot of people will reply to us, making suggestions, making corrections, and so on. And eventually, after some time, you know, that theory or that hypothesis becomes a law. It gets subsumed into the corpus of science. And so in fact, if you see, and that is how science really grows, you know, through making such unknowns into knowns. Now, if you look at two features of science, one is, of course, falsifiability. That gives every person on Earth the right to refute or contest a particular theory. And in fact, that is how theories improve. And this is, of course, a great idea. And it's good for the future. The second aspect is of repeatability. That is basically saying that a law which is formulated in Toronto reasonably holds in Bangalore or Pune. And in fact, it is this repeatability which has made the applications of science spread worldwide. So think of vaccinations or the internet or you know, or lasers and of course the bomb. So in fact, what this repeatability has done is that it has made science into a global program. So in fact, what has happened in the last two or three decades, scientists have come up with a new way of doing science, and that's called big science. And so let me just explain what are the key features of big science. The first feature is that there's a selection of areas on the frontier of science. So right now it is stem cells, it is mathematical models of climate change, it is nanoparticles, and of course the poster boy, machine intelligence. The second feature of big science is that there is, you know, the research in these areas is guided and supervised by a coalition of eminent scientists, you know, elite universities, and very prestigious journals. The third point is that there's an argument that these are the areas of the future. This is what is going to determine society of the future, and that there's an appeal for all scientists to join in and work on these particular areas. So that has, of course, convinced a lot of people and a lot of governments, and a lot of people have put funds into big science. It has also changed the way we look at science. It has made it into a science of excellence of a few scientists a few very talented scientists who are the producers of science, and the rest of us as consumers of science. So, of course, there's been many contesting, you know, many people have contested this idea, and that, you know, they ask, is big science too big to fail? But for us, the important question is big science going to deliver? Is it going to deliver? Is it going to solve Manisha's water problem or Hirabai's cooking energy problem? So if we look at Manisha's problem, I think big science is going to claim that it has actually solved it. So in fact, you know, if you go to Maharashtra, dotted all over Maharashtra are hundreds of RO plants, reverse osmosis plants. And in fact, young lads in these plants are going to, you know, will supply 20 liter jars of pure water at 20 rupees a jar. And eventually, as technology progresses, you know, this cost is actually going to come down. So the problem is solved, or is it? So if you ask Manisha, what she really wants is ample and cheap water, just as in the cities. And that is possible only through community water supply schemes, you know, and you know, common stand ports closer to our home. So really, and the fact is that all these rural water supply schemes are failing all over Maharashtra. So we analyzed hundreds of such water supply schemes, and there were two or three basic reasons why they fail. Firstly, these water supply schemes are sourced through groundwater, through wells, and most of these wells were going dry in summer. The second reason is that, you know, many times these sources of water are far away, and you know, the energy costs are substantial, and then the community cannot pay. So here are two unknowns. You know, how do I test a well? How do I improve a well? And how do I measure the ability of the community to pay? So if these two unknowns became known to the government, you know, the government engineer, I'm sure they would design much better water supply schemes, and the problem, drinking water problem of hundreds of villages in Maharashtra would be solved. So next, let us look at another example. Let us look at Hirabai's question of smoky chulas. So here again, big science will say, well, let's build the ideal, you know, efficient, smokeless chula, cookstove, and let's manufacture it and disseminate it. So, well, we didn't quite do that. We said that just as the chula is also not only a cultural object, but it is also a scientific object. And different women want different things from the chula. Some women want it to, you know, to be more efficient. Some women want it to, you know, create less smoke. Some people want it to use less wood. So given this, so what we suggested were some adaptations, some variations. For example, we gave this jali. So this jali to be added to your chula to improve its efficiencies. So we also suggested many other variations like the grate and so on. So what we saw was hundreds of adaptations all over Maharashtra, and a lot of very happy women and a lot of enterprises. So women actually wanted to share what they had discovered about chulas. So let us just step back a bit and understand what really is happening. So if you go back to this world of science, so this was 50 years ago, there is Hirabai, and there is, say, Kathy from Toronto or Charu from Bangalore. So 50 years now, hence, you see, science, the world of science has grown, and it has grown in a certain direction, the frontier, right? And we see that Kathy and Charu have moved with the frontier, while Hirabai's world has stayed where it is, where it was. So my question is that, you know, if a science which was proximate 50 years ago could not help Hirabai, what chance is that the frontier science of today will help Hirabai? Pretty slim. So in fact, it is likely to help, you know, Kathy and Charu. So if we really want to reach Hirabai, right, science must change the way it looks for problems, it searches for problems, and it explores them. In fact, this is what we, in the two examples, this is what we did. So what the new science must do is go to Hirabai's proximity, understand the goods and services which are being delivered to her, understand the agents of delivery, their science, their protocols, and their policies, and uncover those and discover new problems. Perhaps that is the frontier that we need to explore. So in that mix, actually, that brings me to vernacular science. The vernacular science has two or three simple tenets. The first tenet is look for the underserved. Right? If you want to reach science there, it is the underserved. Look at the services which are delivered. You know, look at the communities, look at the households, look at small factories and enterprises. These are our customers. The second is the realization that it must be done by local regional agents, by college teachers and students, and you know, and regional agencies. And they must do it using the method of science, of careful experimentation, of fieldwork, documentation, and analysis. The third realization is that it must be a synthesis of various disciplines. So even if you want to solve drinking water, it needs groundwater, it needs economics, it needs community thinking, and so on. So these are the three tenets of vernacular science. Sadly, none of this really happens in the current curricula of science or social sciences. So in fact, what scientists are going to ask is that all this is very good, but is it science? Is it hard? Is it interesting? So my answer to all these three is yes. It is indeed all of these three. In fact, the mission of science is to describe reality. And if reality comes as a combination of social and technical factors, so be it. We have to study it. And now the second fact is that you know, groundwater modeling or community economics is as hard as it gets, as intellectually challenging as it gets. The third point is this immersive pedagogy is actually closer to the spirit of science. So really, vernacular science is as good as it gets. Right? And in fact, it is far more accessible to everyone. Anybody can be a vernacular scientist. And it is more likely to deliver the goods, more appropriate solutions. So if I, but more theoretically, if I compare the cycles, the cycle of science and the cycle of vernacular science, they are very similar. Just as, you know, traditional science begins with reality and comes up with theories with scientists in the middle, vernacular science also starts with reality, except it's that it's the lived reality of sadak, bijli, pani. And the scientists are local agents, college teachers and students. And they come up with, their objective is to come with a working model of how that reality is actually delivered. For example, if you think of public transport, it would be, you know, the taluka bus depot, the timetables, the crew schedules, the profit and loss accounts, the maps, and so on. So in fact, just as in science, through iterative cycles, the working model will improve and reality will be delivered. So that is how, you know, vernacular science is the science of delivery. So, and then the next question is, what is the location for vernacular science? And it is obviously the university. So if you look, but it's going to be a very different university. It's a university whose agenda is not to further a particular frontier of science or to generate employees. Its agenda is to serve society and by analyzing its problems. Its job is to guide the market and to strengthen the state. That it should do by really by expanding the through public understanding of what are the issues that face it. Furthermore, you know, the university is a vehicle for the aspirations of society, for, you know, the social, for example, of role models, of trust, of sustainability and equity. So it is through this that, you know, the university becomes actually a cultural asset for society. So let us now briefly go back once more to big science and understand why it did not, or it will not, or it could not, or may not deliver to Hiramai. So first of all, big science comes with a model of delivery. Right? After all, e-commerce delivers through air freight and tracks through GPS. And that's how Kathy gets her coffee beans or Charu gets her laptop. And this model of delivery is actually a big business or the global economy and of, you know, we know it, of driverless cars, of, you know, of big data and of Industrial Revolution 4.0. And we already know that this model has many problems. It has increased inequity, it has decreased employment, it has very selective coverage, and it has very questionable sustainability. So I'm not sure how it will engage with Hirabai or Manisha. So really, the sustainability part brings us to another point. It is a fact that the hard world of Hirabai is probably more sustainable than the world of Kathy. So it is, if we really want a sustainable Earth, we should open another frontier, a frontier which makes sustainable lives more secure and more comfortable, instead of making comfortable lives more sustainable. So I think that what it means is that we really need a new paradigm of science, a science in which, you know, the hard abstract intellectual capabilities of big science come together with the groundedness of the vernacular for a new curriculum in which the laws of science are as important as the social comprehension of science and the delivery of science, where, for example, the chemistry lab or the simulation is no better than the visit to the bus depot and studying timetables or weighing babies in the Anganwadi or measuring trees in the forest. So it is a science where the disciplinary training combines with an understanding of the social and cultural context. It is only after these efforts where students actually learn how to empathize and how to engage in a conversation with community and how to do fieldwork. It is only through this culture, you know, that science will become a culture of the people, for the people, by the people. Otherwise, we will be divided into scientists and experts and their beneficiaries. We don't want that. So really, I think science of comprehension, social comprehension, I think that is going to prepare us for a new way of life closer to nature, of, you know, enhancing the beauty and bounty of the seasons. And perhaps that is the only way that we will sustain the diversity of, you know, life and cultures that still remain on this earth. Thank you.